And welcome back to the highly original Nerd on the Internet Sits in Front of All His Toys Doing Stuff. It's a mood. I'm kidding. It's been a lethargic few weeks for me, and I thought for this latest reorganizing video, I'd slow it down a little bit, do something a little bit different. We're dealing with my Marvel collectibles shelf at the moment. The majority of the reorganizing has already happened. So I have a heap of Marvel Legends figures that I need to unbox, unpackage. And I've got a lot more in a couple of different 100 liter tubs behind me here. I need to sort through them. I'm not going to open all of them, let alone I'm not going to open all of them on camera. Unboxings are a little bit boring. I can understand that, but let's have a chat. Let's have a bit of a, I don't know. Let's see if we can turn this into a bit of a Bob Ross relaxing sort of moment. I really should start by saying I really tried my best and succeeded for a while there to avoid going down the rabbit hole when it came to these Marvel Legends figures. I found them interesting as toys, especially when they were only $20 or $25 once upon a time. But yeah, they didn't really interest me that much, especially the whole encouraging you to buy all the figures as well as the characters you didn't want in order to get the specific build a figure part for the character you did want. And then two things happened. One was Infinity War, and I bloody loved that film. Infinity War felt like the beginning of the end, so I wanted to have something that commemorated these characters we've spent, you know, the better part of 10 years with. The other thing that happened, I think around the same time, one of my local Kmarts actually got in the re-release, was it the re-release? Yeah, the re-release wave of the Civil War Marvel Legends figures. It's that thing they do where they repackage the characters that actually appeared in that particular film with the Build-A-Figure parts instead of the extra comic book specific characters and stuff. So I just grabbed the entire set, and as I'll probably clarify again later, Civil War was one of my personal favorites from the MCU. At the moment, I want to sort of have enough characters to represent the specific films that I like from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Frustrating as some of that has been, certain figures aren't available or are too expensive in Australia because they're, you know, they end up being Comic-Con exclusives, store exclusives. But I've been fortunate. I've been fortunate that I've got most of the figures and characters I want. There's a few left. There's also, frustratingly, a more accurate re-release on the way, but we'll get to that as well. We'll start with the figures that I've already got unboxed. For those of you who have been following my Instagram, you now know why someone that looks like me needs a ring light. I actually unboxed a few of these for a quick little photo shoot that I wanted to do. So here's Captain America and Iron Man from Endgame. I gotta say, I've never liked an Iron Man suit that has originated in the Avengers films. I've never liked the Mark 7. I've never liked the 43. Even the Infinity War armor, for whatever reason. Personal taste, personal aesthetics, I don't think they're bad. Again, it's just personal taste. That was until the Mark 80. Something about that one really resonated. This is the worthy Captain America that was meant to be either Target or Walmart exclusive in the US. And, you know, because of that, people on the aftermarket on eBay were trying to sell that for twice the recommended retail. And even if they were selling it at retail price, the postage, the international postage, was just exorbitant. 3 months later, it ends up in local Aussie stores for about $40, something like that. Yeah, the people who are still asking $100 here in Australia couldn't get rid of theirs. Just could not get rid of theirs. And even then, stores like Zing still have worthy Captain America with the surprise Mjolnir hidden behind his shield. They've still got them on the shelves. Whether it's because people don't want them or people have already paid $100 for them. I just delight in the a-holes who can't get rid of stock now because they've tried to do something sneaky and, you know, take advantage of the stupid people. And also, I really liked Cap's outfit in Endgame as well. I seem to like a lot that originated from that film. Anyway, let's move on. Here's another standard one. Ronan, Hawkeye, when he went off the radar. That one was bought loose, and I think with one other accessory, from the Mega Toy Fair. There's a seller at the Mega Toy Fair who sells lots of Marvel Legends figures, and he will often buy up the whole sets, assemble the Build-A-Figure, and sell the Build-A-Figure separately. He'll also sell the figures without the pieces as well. Speaking of said seller, he also had, I guess, Professor Hulk, Smart Hulk, Build-A-Figure. I think I only liked two or three figures from that range anyway, so to buy Endgame Hulk complete, intact, without having to spend, what is it, $200, $300? Yeah, so I saved a lot of money that day. And another Build-A-Figure that the seller had was, trying to think, he's Endgame Thanos, but would you consider, there was another name for him, like War Thanos or something like that, because technically he's a past version that skipped the entire Infinity War. Yeah. Anyway, so this one was also a assembled Build-A-Figure that the seller sold at the Mega Toy Fair. I really like this version of Thanos. That helped me avoid having to buy the unnecessary figures from that range as well. Let's set those aside so we can open some of these others. Hopefully that ring light worked out. We'll be interesting to see that afterwards. All right, let's see. This was the first wave of Infinity War Marvel Legends figures with the Thanos Build-A-Figure. What do I talk about? So, as you'll see, or as you probably already have surmised, for me at the moment, it's mainly Marvel Cinematic Universe. It's a big thing at the moment. I'm really enjoying it. However, I was first introduced to Marvel stuff, like a lot of kids in the 90s were, by the X-Men cartoon series from the early 90s. Almost 30 years later, that theme song, the X-Men theme song still sort of, still sends me back there every single time. And I think that, in turn, led me to start reading the X-Men comics. And, well, early 90s, it was the years leading into Onslaught, and so I missed a lot, but I think, and I just entered after Magneto drained Wolverine of all his adamantium, so that surprised the hell out of me. Maybe I shouldn't have cut my nails. Hang on. Let's try this. It does nothing for me. Oh, you are really going to make it difficult for me. Let's put her to the side here for now. We've got Captain America from Infinity War as he appeared at, well, for most of that film. Didn't really feel the temptation to read anything else from Marvel around then. What was I into? In the 90s. I think I got into Spawn in the 90s. Once upon a time, I wanted to be a comic book artist. That was mainly because of the Ninja Turtles original comic books. However, comic books industry in the 90s was something interesting. Basically non-existent in Australia, so it kind of diverted me from that venture. I mean, that ignores the part where I may not have been good at illustrating. I guess the X-Men films happened, or was it Blade first? Things I should look up, but don't. Yeah, the X-Men films, what was it, early 2000s? We all thought they were the next best thing, but they really have not aged that well. That snap. That scares me so much. Like, I get the paint, the plastic, you know, kind of fused together if they're there too long. The whole mint and pack thing preserves a lot. I get it, but yeah, Marvel Legends figures are meant to be the midway point between collectible and kids' toy. But they're sort of marketed in a really bizarre way. Well, that's him. So we've got Thanos' head. What's next? Well, we have the Iron Spider. I can't remember how cheap I got that one. Because this is so relaxing. Oh, there we go. I'm impressed. I hadn't seen this up close on the back. They've made him really articulated. I'm impressed. Cap doesn't have that. They've put extra articulation on Spidey's shoulder blades. So here are Iron Spider and Captain America, or Steve Rogers from Infinity War. Apparently you can buy, people are selling an extra one of these so Cap can have two of them. I may do that. I may buy another one. Likeness of Rogers is off, but for whatever reason, a year later, the likeness has got really good. In fact, yeah. But yeah, so those two are almost ready. Thanos's, is that his? That's his left. There's a receipt still here. So one of the things I used to pride myself, I still kind of do, was my goal was to never pay full price for any Marvel Legends figure. And for a while there, I was, you know, able to succeed in that. This is Ebony Maw. He has a Thanos Endgame Build-A-Figure part, but I already have a complete Thanos. Oh, that hair isn't as long as it should be. Let's take this Build-A-Figure part out, leave it out. So if I do have to do anything with it, I can. Maybe I'll sell it off. Maybe I'll make a second Thanos. Boink. Let's deal with some crap. This is comic book version of Malekith. Not the Thor Dark World version, which is a shame. Oh, I gotta be honest, I'm not really interested in the figure. I just want the Build-A-Figure part. So I'm taking that out. Ooh. You being a sneaky shit. Take that out. That's his weapon. And now I can sell that off to anyone that might be interested. We got an arm from that one. Oh, and a weapon as well. So we're getting there. So part of the second Infinity War wave of Legends figures. Two figures from Ant-Man and the Wasp. Here's the thing, the Ant-Man films aren't huge or spectacular, but they're a lot of fun. And I just like Paul Rudd. We've got a leg. Oh, that's one leg.
Where is he?
Yep. That's one leg from the Ant-Man build-a-figure. Then there's the other leg that I bought on its own. The seller that sells the Marvel Legends figures at the toy fairs. He just happened to have that. I think he only wanted $5 for it. After the job lot discount that I got because I bought a lot of figures from him, I think it cancelled out the $5. which also saved me from having to spend $30 or $40 buying this particular figure, which was another one of those comic book versions that no one really cares about. I mean, those things are more about market testing, I think, for Marvel. If people like them enough, I guess. But then again, the comics should be that as well. But no, rambling. But yeah, we've got two legs, an arm, and a weapon. And I like that smirk on his face. But do I want to change that? You know what? I'm going to decide that later. And we'll go to the next one, which is Wasp. What's a fiddly little part? I'm going to have to be careful here. It's all tiny pieces, tiny pieces. I think I stopped reading X-Men comics around about the time the films came out. Because once the films went with the black leather look, the comics started to emulate that, started to adopt those sorts of designs. We really did dupe ourselves into thinking they were cool, didn't we? Like, there was this point where we looked at superhero costumes and thought to ourselves, yeah, all those bright colours, they really don't work on the big screen, don't they? You know, it's that joke from the first X-Men film. What were you expecting? Yellow spandex? And we really want that now. There's this balance between the original character designs and not realism. That's not the objective. It's the designs have to be convincing in the universe they've created. So it's a bloody good job that, you know, artists like Andy Park and Ryan Meinerding, I hope I pronounced that correctly, they've been able to translate original comic book sensibilities with something that is convincing in three dimensions. Ooh, okay, so now I recognise this. There are two backpacks. There are alternates for her. I'm going to put on the one with the wings. I may regret that because it may take up too much room on the shelf. But I think we should be fine. Ant-Man and the Wasp. Let's move these characters aside for a second. Where the hell is it? Here's one I forgot. That I opened already for a photo shoot, so he's a bit loose. It's the Infinity War Thor. There we have a build-a-figure left arm. Well, the figure is already out here. He's got no head. I took that off because I was replacing it with Endgame Thor's head. Even though it wasn't the correct body, I needed a shot. I needed a shot from the back for a specific Endgame themed photo. I probably should have said earlier, if you're a DC fan that has stumbled across this, I already did technically a DC video. Actually, the first video in this Reorganising series was all about my Batman collection. That's as DC as it gets. I have a few other pieces. For me, I like what I like. Well, this was another discounted figure from Toy Fair. from a different seller this time, looking at the price tag on that. So, yeah. That Thor looks really cool. I did enjoy such a rousing scene in Infinity War where he pops up in the middle of the battlefield with Groot and Rocket. So cool. We've got one more. This was... yeah. So these Infinity War figures I bought at the Mega Toy Fair 2019. Infinity War actually came out in 2018. And so the toys would have been out around the same time. They like to do that. And you can kind of tell because one of these characters does not actually look like how he looks in the final film. You know, whatnot with the turnaround of toys, you know, the designs go to the toy manufacturer, they tool it, they manufacture it, and then movie productions, they can change a rendering at some point, and the final product of the film will often be different from the toy. Same thing happened with Star Trek Generations. They originally designed different uniforms, but they abandoned those designs for the Deep Space Nine uniform, and yet the toys had already been manufactured. Anyway, sidetrack. So I bought these a year after, a full year after Infinity War came out. Mega Toy Fair happened after Endgame was released. Endgame was April, May of 2019. 2019 Mega Toy Fair was the beginning of June of 2019. It was Endgame that got me to want to buy these figures. That's right. Because I remember a friend of mine bought this figure, and I was like, "No, I'm good. I won't buy them yet. Whatever. I won't buy them. I'll resist." Now we have Infinity War Black Widow. That was always going to happen, so I'll deal with that later. Let's assemble. Here's the torso of the Build-A-Figure. It's actually rather cool. And I think, like I said before, looks nothing like how he appears in the final film. An arm clicks right in. Satisfying. Here's the other arm. That clicks right in. Ooh, ratchet. That's some ratcheting in that arm. That is actually really cool. Okay, that felt like it went. Ooh. Ooh, he's a big fella. Haven't even got his head on yet, but ooh. Yeah, probably needs a bit of heat. Ooh, no. That is very satisfying. Actually, very tight joints. Let's get his weapon out. That's such a weird weapon. Looks like Minecraft. So the Build-A-Figure for the second wave of Infinity War Legends, the Marvel Legends figures, was this big fella that doesn't even fit on my second camera screen. Cull Obsidian. I mean, look at that beauty. If he stands, yeah. Like, again, this design is not how he appeared in the final film. He actually wears a uniform. He actually wears clothes in the final film. That's a little disappointing. However, this is still a very cool looking figure. So we've got Proxima Midnight. We've also got Ebony Maw. Let's get them all to fit on camera, shall we? And here's one that I ordered. This is another one of those store exclusives in the US, and he was part of a two-pack. A seller in Australia was just selling him individually. Corvus Glaive. Glaive! I can't resist. Yeah. Wow. Oh, don't focus on me. Focus on him. There's Thanos' Black Order. Now, the frustrating thing about this is about a week and a half before I started recording this video, Hasbro announced a special 5-pack re-release of Thanos and the Black Order, but to be much more movie accurate. I need to take a close look at some of the other characters. Carl Obsidian has his movie uniform on. Not only that, the Thanos figure, there's an option to swap out his head and his arm to make him look like post-snap Thanos. I like the Black Order here, but it'll always be frustrating to not have it movie accurate. One of those things, eventually I'll get that 5-pack. I think it might be end of year. At the same time, I'm still pretty pleased with this. That Cull Obsidian was very satisfying to assemble, and he's a big figure. He's a big boy too. I still have Infinity War Thanos to assemble, and I have those pieces with me. However, the dilemma exists then that I also have this special 3-pack of Iron Man, Thanos, and Doctor Strange. I do want to open this up because that Doctor Strange figure is really cool. And this version of Iron Man lights up, whereas I've actually got the pretty bloody useless original Iron Man release Infinity War. Because see, you know, I can finish that Thanos off, but I'm not satisfied with that Thanos figure, whereas I kind of like this 10-year, and ooh, rumbling. I'm kind of more satisfied by this version in the pack here. And there's two different expressions, and that's which that one makes three. He's constipated in that expression, whereas that's a neutral and that's angry. This version of Iron Man that lights up does pop up every now and then for something quite reasonable. That Doctor Strange, however, too exorbitant, on his own costs more than what I paid for this 3-pack. I'm gonna put these aside and go straight to that one. Let's see, here we go. Like I said, I actually did look up these particular figures individually. I let the Iron Man ones go by quite easily. The light up Mark 50. Press on. Off. Okay, cool. We've got some pulsar blasts. Let's fit them in there. Sometimes the less I have to store away accessories, the easier it is to keep track of things. Of course, that time-old tradition of putting his goddamn cape through the back of the bloody container. Right, so he goes through the front, capey goes through the back, peg goes into there. We'll put this. The facial hair bros. Was that the joke? Was that the thing from the comic? I can't remember. I love that. I wish that was in Infinity War at one point. Oh, apparently one of the abandoned ideas for Infinity War was to have Stark and Strange swap outfits. Stark would wear Doctor Strange's cape, but then in order to save Strange, Stark would have his armor fly onto Strange, and then you'd see for the first time an Iron Man armor powered by the Time Stone. Yeah, there we go. They look pretty cool. Let's get Angry Thanos. Relaxing! The Thanos Build-A-Figure is a lot shinier than the 10th anniversary release. And he's a lot darker as well, as opposed to the pale purple here. I'm guessing that's to do with sort of you know, pre-production versus final product. I'm liking the matte finish a lot more as well. It's a lot more vibrant, and I think I prefer that. And there we have Thanos. Yeah, like I said, I prefer this hand pose, sort of the outstretched more than just a fist. Yeah, no, you know what? Do not have any regrets opening that up now, because that worked out well. I have rambled on so much. It's going to be a very interesting edit. So I bought a stack of laser cut acrylic circles, clear acrylic circles. There we go. Here, ordered a stack of them, about 30, I think, from a local supplier by the name of Acrylic Blanks, because that's what these are. They're acrylic blanks. These ones are clear. You can get frosted, you can get colored, and they will cut them out for you. They're all for sort of arts and crafts. They're also for special occasions. You can use them at weddings and the like, presentation sort of dealios. Yeah, but I wanted to use them for action figure stands. You're probably wondering, why don't you get proper action figure bases? Like the NECA ones, for instance. Well, did I even put them here? I like those NECA ones. They're about 9 centimeters, 90 millimeters across. They're just, I gotta be honest, they're way too big. Here's a good example. So 9 centimeters, that's a very big footprint. If I'm going to line up lots of figures, I want to be efficient about the space they use. That's a big footprint, as opposed to 5 centimeters or 50 millimeters. And see, that's the other thing. These things have pegs to put into the feet, and that's always been a fantastic idea. But not all pegs are alike. So all I have to do is just use some blue tack, and instead of blue tacking them to the shelf or the platform that they're standing on, I just put them onto these acrylic bases. And I bought 30 blanks at about 50 cents each. Or at least they're about 50 cents each. However, the more you buy, the more they discount. So I think it might have been like 2 cents or 4 cents off. I can't remember. And you can get them in all different sizes. So all different shapes, I guess, as well. I've only bought from them once. I don't normally promote stuff like this. And look, there are probably a variety of people that do this sort of thing. There are those who do Warhammer or sort of tabletop gaming that use these sorts of things as well. So there's a variety of people out there. But I had a good experience. I got a bargain. And the turnaround time was really quick as well, so only a few days. Yeah, there we go. Much better. And you know, like I said, smaller footprint means you can pose them very close together. Like that. Look at that. Works so well. I mean, this isn't a new idea, and I'm not claiming this is my idea. It's just sometimes I like to promote not having to do the things the usual way. Like, oh, look, everyone's using, you know, such and such. Sometimes go your own way. I was contemplating doing this as a time lapse, but to be quite honest, it's probably not that interesting. So we'll probably do a cut here and then you'll see them all done.
1 hour later.
Okay, so that's most of the Infinity War figures and a few Endgame stuff. Hulk here is not getting one because his feet are pretty large, lucky him. And so he'll be fine. I think the same with Thanos. But yeah, that should be cool. Even just looking at them like this, there's this enjoyment that I'm experiencing. One of the things I forgot to kind of go into is why bother with the Marvel Legends figures? If I wanted something to represent these characters that I've enjoyed over the last 10 years, why not a Hot Toy, for instance, or a Figuarts, Mafex, or whatever other versions, whatever other articulated versions out there, why not those? Well, for one thing, I can't afford Hot Toys every time. If I want to recreate Endgame, for instance, I can't afford a figure from every single Hot Toy version of these characters. That's just not going to happen. Secondly, those other figures, those other variations I butchered the pronunciation of, they're also expensive at, you know, many of them over $100 each, so they weren't going to happen. I might resent some of the marketing practices that Hasbro have undertaken with making certain figures store exclusives and whatnot. I may resent being coerced into buying certain figures just so I can get the Build-A-Figure part. I find ways around them. Like I said before, there are people that assemble these and sell them complete for a bargain, so I don't have to buy those dodgy figures. There are sales on all the time. I just noticed that on the price here, I'm glad that I got worthy Captain America when I did, because I think Zing actually raised the price on him after that initial wave. Like a lot of people who really preferred the 6-inch movie Ninja Turtles by NECA Toys over quarter scales, they like, this is the perfect size for them all. This is the perfect format for them all. Yeah, so I'm going to clear the table by putting these in the display. And once I've done with that, we'll get on to the Endgame figures. So I took a bit of a break. Actually, it's the next evening. These take a while to record and I'm lazy. And I've just noticed, well, I thought I'd completed the Infinity War figures, but I've actually got one more here. In all fairness though, Heimdall was released as the second wave of Endgame figures, because he has a Build-A-Figure part for that for one of the characters there. So yeah, let's get back into it. I haven't looked back at last night's footage yet, so I don't know how much waffling I've done. Basically talking about Marvel, I guess. Oh, I have done... Crack. I've done two Marvel-based cosplays. Both movie versions of things as well. Oh. The first one was movie Magneto. That was done back in 2011. As a way to help encourage a friend of mine who was also doing a Marvel cosplay at the time as well. She was she just needed some moral support, and I thought I'd do a Magneto costume to go with her mystique. But I found the perfect jacket for the Magneto costume. It was like $2 at the Salvos, when I was still going to the Salvos back then. Yeah, that was fun. Took that to Melbourne with us and stuff. The second Marvel cosplay I did, let's put that over there, was Iron Man. And that was a fun one. Did that in 2012 out of foam. It was the Mark VI Iron Man suit. Wait a second, I'll get back to that. But for now, here's Heimdall. He was so cool. I kind of wish we saw more of him. Put him aside for the moment. What's the next one? Oh! Black Panther's Shuri. That was, yeah, this one was released as part of the Hulk Build-A-Figure. And this was from the guy that actually assembled the Build-A-Figures and sold them at toy fairs. Back to my Iron Man cosplay. Yeah, I did that in 2012. I was rushing it. I was hoping to do it in time for the very first Adelaide Oz Comic Con, which was the very first Oz Comic Con ever. The building of that Iron Man costume was... it was looking so good in the lead-up. All the foam bits, everything was looking fantastic. And then the last two nights, I messed it up. I rushed it, and I painted it poorly, and things just did not work out well. And that original helmet, yeah, it was sort of like, oh, no, I just need to get this done. And it did not look very good at all. But it is what it is. Actually, most of my costumes end up that way. I debut them half-finished. And, but since then... I would repair and improve the costume. I'd build... How does this go on? I'd build a new helmet. I'd motorize it. I'd motorize the faceplate. I'd repaint the armor. I'd rebuild bits and pieces. I mean, it wasn't... It was never the best Iron Man armor out there. I'm heavier now than I was 8 years ago, but still, I still had quite the... Iron Man still had quite the muffin top back then, and trying to squeeze myself in a girdle. It was a very short and stocky Iron Man. I actually wore heels underneath the Iron Man boot covers. I wore, what was about 3 or 4 inch heels. Very thick heels, mind you. I mean, I got a lot of practice at Rocky Horror. Yeah, here we go. Oh, look at that. That's wonderful. Oh, she's fantastic. So good. Really, she should be part of... the Infinity War release, although this is how she looked in Endgame. Iron Patriot. Just quickly, when I watched this movie in the cinema, when I watched Endgame in the cinema the first time round, and it was a proper morning first in Adelaide screening, 7:30 on the dot, which means I woke up really early for it. When the Iron Patriot pops up in the final act, I didn't know it was the Iron Patriot. The cinema I went to, their screens aren't really the best. So the colour didn't come up properly. which is sort of weird to admit. It wasn't until the next evening that I saw it again with friends at another cinema, the same chain cinema, but it was just a newer screen, that I realised, wait, those are red and blue colours. The Iron Patriot, yeah, so, minor thing there. My Iron Man cosplay, despite the muffin top, despite the heels, despite, you know, the girdle, it was always so much fun to wear. I mean, especially once I got the faceplate working. Like, it wasn't difficult to breathe, it was just claustrophobic after a while, when you're looking through just the eyes were lit up, but you could all just see underneath, kind of like my Leonardo animatronic head there. Also, I won an award for that cosplay. As shitty as it was, compared to what I can do now, compared to what so many others can actually do, I entered that into a cosplay contest. Oh, your legs. So I did a few repairs after a couple of months, after that initial debut. I entered into a contest because the original idea for the costume I had messed up and not completed in time. Optimus Prime. They let me change it last minute. And I went up on stage in my Iron Man costume, very hungover. It was the Sunday afternoon. I'd had a few. Basically channeling my best Tony Stark. It wasn't a very good Tony Stark. I just said it was my best Tony Stark. I won first place for best male cosplay. $300, baby! I spent that prize money very quickly. There's something about wearing that Iron Man suit, hungover or not, that gives you a bit of swagger. In fact, most armored cosplays do that for me. Colonel Rhodes, aka the Iron Patriot. That's a hefty bastard. Who else do we need to open? We have Valkyrie here as well. Actually, I'm really glad to have Valkyrie. I have the Thor Ragnarok Marvel Legends figures as well. That was another wave of figures that I waited until no one bought them so that they would go cheap. Oh, it's one of these things again. I'll have to double check to see whether or not they included a Valkyrie in there. Because I know they're... Tessa Thompson is bloody awesome as that character, and the way she struts the way she strutted down the bridge from, was that ship called the Monaro? I can't remember. I remember they were named after Aussie cars. Okay. We've got another builder figure part. We'll put that aside. Pack this up. I got to admit, she looks bloody awesome. In the span of maybe 2 years, the likenesses for these characters just got better and better. When you compare earlier versions of these characters to the most recent release, good lord. We'll get to one that really impressed me too. But yeah, this endgame wave seems to be more kind of, who haven't we released sort of thing. And so Civil War Vision is what we get here with a build-a-figure part for this wave. Vision did get an Infinity War release. He was part of an exclusive two-pack. Also featured Wanda, or the Scarlet Witch. He's got very translucent parts. Yeah, he's translucent. If you've made it this far, thank you very much. I do appreciate that. Doink. Let's put your cape back on. I'm not sure if this camera picks it up. Some of his parts, especially in the forearms, they're translucent. They're a translucent plastic, which I find absolutely fascinating. And considering this is the first or only Vision figure that I've bought, I don't know if they've done that previously. His cape, very translucent. Obviously translucent, but they've done same with his body parts too. We have one more figure to open. It's yet another Captain America, but as I like to call him, America's ass. Yeah, it's a version from that back in time sequence. I was about to say flashback, but technically it's on a flashback. And that looks cool. It looks like, I imagine the earlier version of this wasn't as detailed or as impressive as this one. This feels somewhat robust for some reason. Or maybe it's because it's just brand new out of pack. It just looks really good. So we've got various pieces here. Let's start assembling. I've been planning to do... Oh, come on. I've been planning to do another Iron Man costume at some point. But I got to admit, I really need to lose this weight again. I have a lot of cosplay plans that I never get to. And this year of all years with nothing else on really would have been the perfect time to catch up on all those projects. But in all honesty, I just haven't been in the mood for it. Kind of escaping to all this has been a little more beneficial to my mental health in between, you know, everything going on and also looking after a family member. And there we go. We have Thor. Out of shape Thor. Sort of traumatized Thor, I guess. I thought he did that well. As an overweight person myself, don't take my words as for any endorsement of anything, because other people have their opinions on it as well. I kind of wish they did a release of Thor at the end of Endgame, during the big fight where he magically got his armor back on, but he didn't magically become slim again. So I kind of wish they did that version instead of the Big Lebowski here. I do enjoy this a little more than I should. So looking on the back of the pack, it reminded me I forgot to bring these two out because I hadn't decided what to do with them yet. So I bought two different releases of Pepper Potts in the rescue armor. But this is the one that has the Professor Hulk, Smart Hulk, build-a-figure part, which I don't really need. And I hadn't gone around to opening it yet. However, this year, as part of this third Endgame wave, they re-released a lot of those previous figures. So the two new ones, technically, is Black Widow and Black Panther. But then again, Black Panther, I don't know, is he a new one or is he a redo of the movie Black Panther? So I'm going to put this one away because I don't really need this version. I don't need that build-a-part figure. These are the same accessories as Infinity War Widow. So that's pretty cool. I like that. Yeah, I felt like the previous two waves were definitely missing her. Like, let's face it, we are way beyond this whole Where's Black Widow stuff, because yeah, that was a legit thing. They were not releasing Black Widow toys for whatever reason, and Black Widow was not appearing on any of the Avengers merch aimed at kids. So to have to make that sort of weird oversight for the Endgame release, it was just remarkably bizarre. What's that say? Low battery? Wow. All right, let's move on to Black Panther. I'm recording this in the second half of October, and so it's been a few weeks since the passing of Chadwick Boseman, which came as a massive shock because he was so good, and you didn't realize how good he was either. Yeah. One of those reminders about how we take things for granted. Would have loved to have seen more from him. Coincidentally, I bought one of his other films that I found for cheap on Blu-ray, which I should get around to watching. The Outpouring was quite immense, and it kind of helped identify what sort of an impact he had. So that's very cool. Very happy with that. He's very cool. Long live the king. Accessories I'll probably put elsewhere. Final figure. Marvel's Rescue, because copyright. Well, trademark, sorry. You can't trademark the word rescue because that's a normal generic word. So it has to be Marvel's Rescue. Wow, this is a beautiful figure. Such a nice blue. Let's put that away. God, that's a big pile of boxes. Which one do I want to put on? Now, that is very cool. Fans were wanting to see this for ages, and you know what? Should have been more of her, but it's one of those things where Endgame was basically a celebration of the MCU's existence, so it was more about, here's something you like, here's something you like, here's a moment you like, applaud this. I don't blame them. I certainly enjoyed it. So, righty. I'm going to do these off camera because they do take a while. I'll arrange them on the shelf, and once I've done that, I may be able to move on and show you what the display actually looks like.
Avengers! Assemble.
Right, here we are at my Marvel cabinet, finally. As I said before, it's predominantly Marvel Cinematic Universe stuff, mainly because that's what interests me at the moment, mostly. So all this stuff used to take up one or two shelves along the main wall there, and it felt like an afterthought. And then there was the other stuff, the larger pieces that weren't together. So all this rearranging and reorganizing has been about putting together and collecting all the different collections into a cohesive display. And yeah, we're going to start with what I've been spending, you know, last few nights unboxing. You know what? I suspected it would happen, but I'm still surprised at how quickly this shelf has filled out. There are a couple of empty spots that I hope to fill out in future, but yeah, I'm actually very impressed. I don't know, I'm always impressed with myself. No, I mean, I'm impressed with how many characters there are. I'm impressed with how this looks. I'm really enjoying it. For a while there, I had a bit of a tough time trying to figure out how to display them. I knew that it would be like this, but what would I use to stand them on? You know, it has to be able to display everything. It has to actually fit the figures as well. So I was going between, you know, the bamboo steps that I have been using for the warmer colored shelves, but I also had these plastic pantry organizers. I keep finding these for cheap at Savers for like, oh, the price is still on here. This is $3. And these are okay, and I've been using them for a while, but for whatever reason, I just didn't like the look of the gray. I got really pedantic about that for some reason. Probably because these are white shelves, maybe. I don't know. So I just reused some of the MDF platforms that I had built previously for other sections of the collection. Up the back there, we've got both versions of Thanos and the children of Thanos, or the Black Order. We've got Proxima Midnight and Corvus Glaive together, because, of course, that's how they appear together on screen in Infinity War. And also in the comics, they're apparently a couple. I've also decided to split these between Infinity War and Endgame. You know, we've got Infinity War Cap over that side, as well as Infinity War Black Widow. And then we've got Endgame Cap and Endgame Widow over here. They've also been grouped into how they traveled during those films. We've got Iron Man and Doctor Strange side by side there, along with the Iron Spider, the Spider-Man up there as well, because they were on an adventure together. Heimdall and Thor. I would prefer to have the Pirate Angel figure in there, but one day if I can find a cheap enough one. Also down the front here, Cap and Black Widow, along with Black Panther and Shuri. I've hidden away sort of behind Hulk, both Ronan and, let's say, traumatized Thor in the back there. That was very specific. They're not really showing themselves. They're not kind of doing any fancy poses. That just worked for me. There are also other figures that I have still boxed up that I'm still deciding on, because they technically weren't from these waves, but they would fit nicely anyway. Hulk still needs a shirt. I think I might need to hunt down a tiny little cardigan for him or something. Well, oh, wait, got that wrong. So yeah, I'm pretty much Team Iron Man. I remember the Civil War. I've dedicated the middle shelf to my favorite MCU film, Civil War. Captain America, Civil War. Yeah, the irony of being on Team Iron Man and an Iron Man fan, but my favorite of the MCU films is a Captain America film. I decided to unbox the Civil War Legends figures off camera. They were actually a random find. I stumbled upon them at a Kmart one night. And the one I went to had at least two sets of these. This was the re-release wave, where they actually had all the characters in that wave appeared in the film, and the Build-A-Figure that people actually want. And the Build-A-Figure in this case is Giant Man, who, I gotta be honest, I thought the figure would be a lot bigger, but then again, this does sort of make sense. I do want to point out, you can see Scott Lang's expression behind those lenses, and it really, really works. I just love that little bit of detail. We've got Team Iron Man on one side, we've got Team Captain America on the other side. I decided to bring the Vision that came with the Endgame release. He was labeled as Civil War on the box. I decided to put him here, and I've put him on a mini doll stand as well, just to have him floating above everyone else. I've done the same with Scarlet Witch. She's floating there just a little bit above the ground. And also Falcon. He's got his wings spread, swooping in there. There are a couple of figures missing. First of all, the Spider-Man figure was only released as a special exclusive 3-pack with battle damaged Iron Man and Cap. That's too expensive, probably won't do that. I'll probably just hunt down a Homecoming figure somewhere. And they never released a Black Widow in this range. Not that I could find. Curiously enough, I think, thanks to other fans online, I've been able to learn how to customize my own. If you take a closer look at Endgame Widow's figure, that's not accurate to the movie. That's actually a remold of the Infinity War Widow figure, just without the green vest. But the thing with the Infinity War figure is that is meant to resemble what she left wearing at the end of Civil War. Almost, so technically speaking, that's her Civil War outfit. All I need now is just a head with the appropriate, I guess you could call it the Charlie's Angels Farrah Fawcett hairstyle, and which I have discovered a source for. And yeah, I can get a custom of that. In the back here, this big Avengers panel is actually from Marvel Select. And those were the closest to action figures that I was purchasing for the MCU for a while there. Yeah, the Diamond Select stuff, they have the figure, really well done for the most part, and they have a bit of a diorama piece where you can connect them all together. But yeah, they're at the back there. We've got the 30cm talking, electronic talking figures. I think they interact with one another. I think I found all those at Savers for like $4 or $5 each. We've got the die-cast stuff, which I've sort of fallen out of. They're all right. So I'm not as enamored with die-cast stuff as I used to be. And I've also, on either side, I've got an Iron Man and Captain America Q-fig, both specifically from Civil War. I don't know if I mentioned this elsewhere. I prefer Q-figs over pop vinyls. Q-figs are by Quantum Mechanics. They used to be called Q-pops once upon a time until they changed it for obvious reasons. And I've got more of them down here, but we'll get to. Apart from the missing figures, I'm really liking this. I will admit, maybe it's a little too crowded. Maybe I should just stick to the Legends figures, perhaps. But for now, I'm enjoying this. Oh, wow, it smells in here. What are you thinking about? I'm thinking there's a lot of stuff on this bottom shelf. So the bottom shelf is pretty much the remainders, the leftovers, the stuff that I can actually display or have room for. This one's going to be a work in progress. However, there's a few cute items that I have here. For instance, the Q-figs that I mentioned earlier. I think, yeah, some of these were Loot Crate exclusives, I think, that I would find for cheap at Savers and pick them up. We've also got the Thor Ragnarok Q-figs. I'm very impressed with the size of the Gladiator Hulk. And the wonderful little thing they've done here is the base of his Q-fig actually fits Thor right in there. He slots right in. Back there, we've got some more Marvel Select figures. There's a Mark 3. No, that's the Mark 4 from Iron Man 2. There's also the Mark 6. The Mark 6 is what I base my cosplay on. They're okay, you know, for the most part. You'll notice there are also some Marvel Legends, some random Marvel Legends around the place here. Actually, I picked them up from Savers or Toy Fairs for like $10 each. Here in the middle is Angela. It was part of the Guardians of the Galaxy wave of Legends figures. So that's a character created by Neil Gaiman for Todd McFarlane's Spawn series. There's a video that explains all that legal kerfuffle. She's now a Marvel character in the comics, and people are guessing that she might pop up in the MCU at some point. I bought that figure because I was a fan of Spawn once upon a time. And, you know, finding vintage Spawn figures is sometimes a bit of a hassle. So I thought, well, bugger it, I'll get that one. Yeah, and that Angela was actually the first Marvel Legends figure I bought. It was also the first one I opened before this year anyway. Right there is another Mark VI Iron Man about to take off. That was another Figuarts. It was actually found complete and in box behind the jewelry counter at Savers for only $20. I do that a lot. Over there is a Hot Toy, one of the few Hot Toys that I have in my collection. And that was back in the day when Hot Toys didn't require you to sell a kidney. On top of that, I got a discount on eBay, so I thought, you know, why not? Oh, and the oldest figure that I have on here, I think, is this Mego Spider-Man from 70 something, let's check, 1974. This was another random Savers find in like a $3 or $4 toy bag. And, you know, he seems a little beat up. Someone has tried to repair his suit. I still think re-releasing Mego in 2020 is like trying to make Fetch happen. You know, if you're making characters that haven't existed before, sure, great. But, yeah, I don't know. That once you get rid of the vintage appeal of it, then I'm not sure why you bother. But, yeah, that was a really cool find. Yeah, as always, this sort of miscellaneous leftover shelf will, is always in a bit of flux. Mind you, the real attraction of my Marvel display happens up top. Getting old.
Probably before 2018, this might have been the focus or the extent of my Marvel or MCU collection. It was just the larger props. Starting with Captain America over there. I don't have much of a problem with that outfit. If you're taking into account that Agent Coulson had a hand in designing it, it actually makes perfect sense. However, that was one of the earliest quarter scale figures I bought, and it's from NECA Toys. I found it on Gumtree for like $20. It's an unwanted birthday present, apparently. The glue around his torso actually came loose, and so I glued that back, and kind of, at $20, you can't argue with that. The other quarter scale figure, again, not the favorite of the Iron Man suits, but he was cheap. He was broken as well. All that was wrong with him was the hand plate had snapped off at the hinge. Bit of blue tack, not really gonna play with him. Why not? It's still very cool to have. Another quarter scale figure, Homecoming Spider-Man. That was half price at Zing, and I went to two different places for it because the first place I went to, the only one they had left was, had been opened and put into their display cabinet. Yeah, and they said that's still the price they were advertising. I'm like, well, wait a second, no. Your discount of half price or 50% specifically implies brand new in box. Purely on the principle of the matter, I drove to a different Zing store, bought it brand new in box. Seriously, X display needs to be less than what you're charging for still in box. That's, if you're incapable of doing that, you really need to piss off. But yeah, before he was just standing on the shelf here, kind of boringly. I just, you know, I do that with most of the figures anyway. However, I just thought with Spider-Man, I you know, he needed to be active, he needed to be energetic, he needed to be in motion. So, and yeah, made him a little more active up there. And he's flanked by a couple of helmets. So from my crappy DIY award-winning helmet to this really, really nice an affordable replica. It's based on the Mark III, which is technically also the Mark IV and the Mark VI, I think, if memory serves. But it's a really nice helmet. It's also a little tight on my massive melon. That's what happens when you have a giant head, unfortunately. I actually got that at a Christmas sale, or was it a post-Christmas sale? I got it for hella cheap, that's all I remember. Similar with the Black Panther helmet as well. They're Marvel Legends, so, you know, continuing my goal of not paying full retail price for Marvel Legends figures, Marvel Legends items. That is a really cool helmet. Lights up, it pulsates, and the lenses flip open as well. During this rearrangement, I've actually upgraded how I displayed those helmets. Now, with my cosplays, I like to display my headgear. And for a while there, I was using PVC pipe or even just packaging tubes on a bit of a flange, something cheap, something easy. You put the helmet on top and it just sits there right like that, because foam mannequin heads like this, well, they're kind of flimsy. You know, these were like $8 each, but they really, they're not weighted in a way that works. They become top heavy. They just don't work. For a while there, I was using this one, this fiberglass head that I left the price on here. This was $4 at Savers, and it was actually working for the longest time for the Iron Man helmet, but I could only find one. And if I was to track down more of these in any style, basically proper fiberglass mannequin heads, too expensive. I actually stumbled across a really good sort of DIY hack or tip. On Twitter, the actor Rahul Kohli, who is better known for his role on iZombie, he was actually passing on an idea that he found on Reddit. He was looking for a way to display his Star Wars helmets, and there were people on Reddit that were suggesting paper towel holders. It's really quite ingenious, and there's different designs and everything like that, and they work really well. And I found a few, but then I also found toilet roll holders, which are much longer. Not only did I find wooden ones, I also found stainless steel ones. These two are actually IKEA ones that I found at Savers. So I bought these for like $2 or $3 each. Polished them up, cleaned them up, put some foam on the top of it. Even though there's foam padding inside the Black Panther helmet, I didn't want to damage the foam in the helmet. Also, that foam helps with friction in holding, in balancing the helmet out properly, so it doesn't tip forward. Look, they're toy replicas, I get that. There's something classy about how they look with the stainless steel displays. That works really, really well. Sticking with Marvel Legends, you remember when Toys R Us Australia was starting to close down and they were discounting stuff heavily? So that's how I got Thanos' Infinity Gauntlet. Oh, I woke up early for that sale. Thor's hammer was a Gumtree find for a roughly half price. And it's actually really nice. Yeah, I wouldn't call it robust. I wouldn't take this to a con and twirl it around like you're about to fly out. But yeah, it's like all of them, you know, they all light up and make noises. I think the mic picked that up. There's this little trick here. Press a button, say name, and Thor. Odin. Loki. Odin. 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 I don't know. We have here T'Challa, King T'Challa. In 30 centimeter 1/6 scale form. There's a bit of a story behind this. So when Black Panther was released in early 2018, the toys came out, and Sean and I were keeping an eye out for all those toys. When we stumbled upon the were they called deluxe Marvel Legends? The larger Marvel Legends sized figures. Originally they were like $60, maybe $70. Captain America, Iron Man, whoever else was being released at the time. This pops up at a Toys R Us for $120. Now keep in mind, $120 Australian. We're sitting there going, wait a second, those other figures from this same line, this same range, were only $60 or $70. 5 months later, how does this get released at $120? Fast forward maybe 6 months later, and I stumble into a cash converters, my local cash converters, and they actually got in a whole range. They got in a few of those larger Marvel Legends figures, but they also had Black Panther. $50. Bugger it, I'm getting this bargain, less than half price, yay. I later gifted that to Sean for Christmas. So, you know, a whole year later, these pop up at Zing for, you know, $68. And I'm like going, wait a second, what? Why was there such a difference between that first release and second release? I was able to buy it thanks to a friend's employee discount, and so I got it much cheaper than that. And then a month later, they were doing half price on those things. People were buying them up at $30, $40 and then trying to sell them off at $80. And then Chadwick passes away. And so you've got some of these people asking way too much for these things. And I finally decided to open this one up. I need a little more. I needed Chadwick to be on here. I needed the King to be on here. Also, ideas for the future. I might bring Hot Toys Widow up here, perhaps, because it's a larger figure. I'd love to have a proper Captain America shield in the back there somewhere. They're releasing a version of the shield that you saw at the end of Endgame and will feature in Falcon and the Winter Soldier series. That might get on display back there. Sparse as it looks, I'm fairly happy with it right now. So all the unboxing that I've been doing has been really beneficial because it has freed up some space to, well, be able to properly store and protect my leftover Marvel toys. This is all full of Marvel Legends stuff that I've
left in box that I am undecided on at the moment. At one point, I was hoping to collect the Quantum Suit versions. They've released the Black Widow, Hawkeye, and Quantum Suit, and they've got spare heads. So I found a couple of spare Quantum Suits. This was like $30. Having a closer look at them, the fact that they're not accurate sort of makes me less enthusiastic about that idea. One of the earliest Marvel Legends waves that I bought complete was the Thor Ragnarok wave. Yeah, they were about half price. I decided to pick them all up. I really like Thor Ragnarok, and I really want to build the Gladiator Hulk Build-A-Figure. Oh, you remember how these bloody things were, however much they supposedly were? They were like $100 brand new. But then I found this one at Cash Converters for $59, and then they were having a 15% off sale on all toys, so I got it even cheaper than that. And then Maya started discounting them all at half price. Yeah, I liked Iron Man 3. I really did. I think that's a better film than most people will admit, because that wasn't an Iron Man film. That was a Tony Stark film. Very, very important clarification. And I really liked how they handled the Mandarin. I'm an Asian Australian. I don't want to see outdated Asian stereotypes out there, up there. I want to see, you know, I want to see you transform that into something proper. Whether or not you make a commentary on the type of stereotypes that's all based on, or you just cast a really good Asian actor to do a departure from the traditional Mandarin, which I think we're getting with Shang-Chi. I'm looking forward to that. Do either one. Now Marvel are doing both, so. So I really regret not getting these when they were brand new, or at least when they were on sale. For whatever reason, I kept holding it off. I go, I'll get that the next day. There's a whole pile of them here at this store, that's fine. And then they disappeared. Why do I really want this one? It's actually the voice of Tom Holland on here. If you're unaware, Tom Holland actually said that he wanted to voice his own toy. They let him do it, and
I love this mask. It helps me focus my spider sense. How'd you like my new suit? Yeah, me and Iron Man built it. I'm your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
That is really cool. Yeah, it's actually his voice, which rarely happens. Speaking of Spider-Man, here's a quarter-scale Spidey from the Sam Raimi, Tobey Maguire era. It's a pretty cool figure. He's just missing a thumb there, but that's about it. For $6 at Savers, I'm really not complaining. And you know, I didn't mind those films, but I didn't really need something to represent it. The only reason I bought this is, apart from being a very, very cool articulated figure from that era, I really just wanted to compare it to the other quarter scale that I have at the moment. Yeah. Yeah. Just as I thought. They're both Spider-Man figures. Popping in here because I just remembered I had this box in storage and I was just able to get into it as well. It's full of vintage X-Men movie figures still intact. The plastic is all yellowing, unfortunately, but still in pack. I think I got them for like $10 or $12 per pack at the Brighton Sunday market one day. They were just sitting there. I grabbed a whole heap of them, and then on the way out, I grabbed the remaining ones. You know, for the longest time, I'd been planning on opening these up and maybe displaying them. See, I was glad that I got both Magneto and Xavier. Because, of course you wanted those two. Oh, it was, yeah, massive score. I was so proud of myself. Such a shame that the director is quite the monster. Back into storage you go. This already feels good. This is nice and tidy. I'm enjoying this. This can get packed up. This goes straight in the storeroom. I've got the display almost how I want it. I've still got one more item here. They call it the power gauntlet on the box, but it's the nano gauntlet in the film. This was a Cash Converters purchase for
a smidge over half price. You know, I wanted to complete the set, you know, pinchy and grabby. It's already lit up because it moved in there. Move that out of the way for now. Because I'm mature, that's why. And that's actually done really well. There you go. That's cool. Let's go put that in the display. Bed goes up, bed goes down. 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 Bed goes up. I'm not getting into the whole costume. Honestly, that's too much effort to get into that girdle, especially for so little views like the last video. I think I say this at the end of every video. There's something cathartic and fun about the reorganizing. I love reorganizing. I love cleaning things as well. I love getting things where they should be. And the way this looks right now, I'm really happy with it. Ooh. Of course. The lights in the bottom cabinet are hooked up to the same switch as the video game cabinet. So, yeah, we'll do the traditional ending and thank you for watching. Oh, wait. There we go. And... hey! Bed goes up, bed goes down. 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 Bed goes up, bed goes down.